I get a minute to test my mic. 1 second? Okay. Thank you kindly for that introduction. Please have a close look at this slide and tell me if you think these people are motivated. Now, some will say yes, some will say no, and many of you will say you're not sure. And that really is the point of this slide, that the first gentleman may be running a triathlon tomorrow and today he's resting. The next may go straight in and sit at the smoothie bar. Motivation is not something that someone has or does not have. It's dynamic and fluctuating, and it depends on many factors. What we see in our offices and our emergency rooms is really just this. It is a snapshot, and we can't make a judgment call. So, you would think that having a heart attack may lead John to lose weight, a diagnosis of asthma may lead Raj to quit smoking, or malignant melanoma may lead Sarah to stop suntanning. Yet, we are not always sensible creatures. Unhealthy behaviors are common, and in fact, treatment non-adherence is common. Less than 20% of patients actually do what their doctors advise them to do. And 80% of our healthcare delivery is towards chronic disease, which health and behavioral lifestyle is the primary factor. So our patients don't just do what we tell them to do, yet we often find ourselves struggling with this. Neuroscience shows us, and there's proof, that the more we push, the more pushback we get. If we spent 10 minutes now arguing whether my hair is black or brown, you will more strongly believe your position after those 10 minutes. So we as health professionals, when we fully occupy a side, that leaves the other side for the patient. So let's talk about understanding change, and a great way is the stages of change. I'm going to walk you through this with a smoker. Let's say her name is Sarah and she's happily smoking away without a thought in the world. That's pre-contemplation. Let's say her grandmother gets diagnosed with cancer and she starts thinking about it. Contemplation. Grandmother dies a horrible death. She quits. That's action. She stays away from smoking. That's maintenance. She meets a new guy who's a smoker and relapses, but she's thinking it's just temporary. She's back in contemplation. So these are the stages of change that every behavior, whether it's eating fruits and vegetables or keeping your desk tidy, that everyone goes in. Yet our healthcare system often treats everyone like we're in action. We don't use the tools we have for the other stages. We are being suffocated, really, by the burden of chronic disease and lifestyle. So my last 10 years have been spent dealing with or working with teenagers who are drug addicted, mentally ill, and pregnant women who are using substances. Some may think they're unmotivated, others are stuck in contemplation, feeling overwhelmed by the tasks at hand. And I can tell you that when we match our treatments and interventions, people do change. We can't just wait for someone to hit rock bottom or have a heart attack. We want to match our interventions. And there is an art and science behind this. It's called motivational interviewing, and I hope to give you a bit of a taste of that tonight. There is over 50 years of research, over 800 published studies on motivational interviewing. It's being used around the world and rapidly growing in diabetes, obesity, cardiology, mental health, and even in management, because how many people actually do what their boss wants them to do? So management companies are doing this. So my hope is that we truly understand the factors that lead to change, and that we match our interactions and not just recommend weight loss, but actually motivate weight loss through lifestyle change. And really, ultimately, I'm hoping this works. Can you hear me? Ultimately, I'm hoping that we can appreciate the most important factor we can bring to our system really is ourselves. That when our patient walks in the door and sits in our office, that we realize that we become the healthcare system, despite our frustrations with that system. There's an opportunity for change there, and that the human interaction is the most powerful way to do that. And we don't waste it simply by giving information that can be found on the internet. In fact, we can change our interaction from face to face, I'm the expert giving you information and advice, to really shoulder to shoulder. Let's look at a common problem collaboratively, looking towards solutions and answers. I often tell my patients that this is their mountain to climb. I'm simply their guide. I can tell them what shoes to buy, how much water to drink, and what route to take, but ultimately it is their journey to take that, to take those steps. So if we think of chronic disease, if we were to do a simple exercise and ask our patients on a scale of 1 to 10, if they could wish upon a star, how important would it be for them to quit smoking, lose weight, manage their depression and diabetes, what number would they give that? Many would say a 10, a 9, an 8. If we ask them on that same scale from 1 to 10, how confident are they that they could quit smoking, lose weight, manage depression or diabetes? Many would give a much lower number, a 2, 3, 4, and 5. And we can say, the issue isn't importance. We don't need to tell you more about the risks and all the consequences. It's confidence. And we can work and build towards that. So how do we get to confidence? I'd like to review and leave with you the science behind movement and change. Is study after study after study has shown us that the most effective clinician, regardless of their education or profession or training, has the same three qualities over and over and over again. And those qualities are simply genuineness, warmth, and empathy. So my hopes for a better healthcare system is that we can match our treatments to motivation, understand the stages of change, and bring ourselves into the equation to not just recommend, but really motivate and inspire lifestyle change towards positive health. So thank you.